joining us tonight. We're singing number 186. Number 186, I Will Follow Jesus. Let's sing that third verse together, please.
Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside the Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that he has trod, up to where they gather all the hills of God. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere he leads me, I will follow on.
Yeah. You ever watch somebody be led by the hand that can't see? They're a little bit timid. You know, it's a frightening thing. But, you know, we're not like that with Jesus. We don't second guess his judgments. We're not scared to do what he says. We just do it. Amen? Yeah, I will follow Jesus. You know, let's go ahead and look at our announcements tonight. I heard there's some really good things coming up next weekend. For one thing, we got a Singspiration, and I like the way Kenneth Mickey put it this morning. Not going to say which one's more important, the potluck or the Singspiration next Sunday night. So that's going to start about 5:30. Yeah, the potluck will be at 5:30, so you want to get here around 5. They say, you know, being early is actually on time. If you're not at least 5 minutes early, you're late, they say. That's what I was always told at work. You come running in there. Anyway, quit it. So we're going to have a church car show here August 6th in the late afternoon. Bring your sunblock, a good hat, and an old car if you got one. Borrow one if you have to. Make it happen. Rent one. Could you rent an old car? I suppose so. All right. Everyone's encouraged to come. Live music, food, and fun. All right. Even if it's a little bit warm, we'll take care of that. I'll keep a hose going out front or something. Yeah. You know, it was interesting. We had a pretty good-sized birthday party at my house about a week ago, and little kids doing all this stuff. When it came down at the end of it, they were just content to run around in the sprinkler. Good old-fashioned fun. Can't beat that, right, in the summer day, running through the sprinkler. Doesn't get any better than that. So there might be some of that next weekend here. I don't know. All right. Lots of very important things to pray about. And, of course, me being the head of the school, we are always asking, we covet your prayers for the school. So please be a part of that, even if you're praying for us. We really appreciate it. Thank you. As I look across this room, I see many faces that have given their heart and soul over the years to see to it that that thing keeps going. And I thank you for that very much. All right. Let's turn to another song here. Number 207. 207, please. The Lily of the Valley. Let's sing the first two verses sitting down, and then the third verse will stand up. Finish this song on standing up. The Lily of the Valley, 207.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The Lily of the Valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. Sorrow, he's my comfort. In trouble, he's my sting. He tells me every care on him to roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Oh, he all my griefs has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart midnight. hallelujah. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Please stand with me, if you will. Let's sing that third verse. He will never, never leave me. Here we go.
He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Amen. Good singing tonight. Brother Steve Raymond, would you lead us in prayer, please, brother? Amen. Please be seated. You know, an old preacher friend of mine, he's since passed away, but when he would come visit me, I'd go sit out in his camp trailer with him and have coffee, and I'd say, hey, brother, how many sermons you keep on hand? I'm just curious. He goes, oh, about 200. 200 sermons, I can, you know. Always got something in his back pocket. It's always good to have a backup plan, see? Do your homework ahead of time. So right now I'm kind of fishing. I'm noodling, like for catfish. Well, I'm not calling you guys fish, so. But does anybody have a song they would like to sing tonight? For a special. You got one in your back pocket you've been working on? Or a piano piece? So anyway, think about it. I'll give you one song to think about it. And if you got something under your hat or in your back pocket, go ahead and bring it tonight. Brian Taylor, you want to sing a special tonight? All right, thank you. So we'll sing one more song and then we'll turn it over to you. All right. So, number 223. Mr. Mickey's preached this morning about the fight, the true fight, the important fight, and you know, this song, 223, rings familiarity. Sound the battle cry. So let's sing that together. Let's fight the devil. Let's win this battle. Number 223. Here we go.
Sound the battle cry. See, the foe is thine. Raise the standard high.
About half throttle. You know, like when you push down on your accelerator in your car, half throttle. So I want you guys on some parts of this song to give it full throttle. Let's try it. See those double F's? Step on it.
O thou God of all, hear us when we call. Help us one and all by thy grace. When the battle's done and the victory's won, may we wear the crown before thy face. Crowds and soldiers rally round the banner. Ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna. Christ is captain of the mighty throng.
Hey, that sounded pretty good. I could hear you guys. That was encouraging. All right. Well, Brother Brian Taylor, are you ready to take the stage, brother?
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much. We'll turn things over to Brian at this time.
You guys have heard a lot of times, but
living below in this old sinful world. Comfort can afford. Striving alone to face temptation sore. Oh, won't you tell me where could I go but to the Lord? Where could I go? I go needing a refuge for my soul, needed a friend to save me in the end. Oh, won't you tell me where could I go but to the Lord? Now neighbors are kind, oh I love them, everyone. We get along with sweet accord. But when my soul needs manna from above, could I go but to the Lord? Where could I go? Oh, where could I go? Needing a refuge for my soul. Needing a friend. Tell me where could I go but to the Lord? Oh, life here is grand with friends I love so dear. Comfort I get from God's own word. Tell me where could I go but to the Lord? Where could I go? Oh, where could I go? a friend to save me in the end. Oh, won't you tell me where could I go but to the Lord? Oh, where could I go but to my precious Lord? Amen.
Thank you, Brian. That was a treat. Speaking of treats, we're in for one tonight. I was told that we have a video of the Jess Valley Bible Camp coming right up, and then we will have our evening message after that. Thank you for your singing and for your playing tonight, everyone. So at this time, we'll go ahead and enjoy that camp video right now.
Too long, the church has been an underdog to the So it's a little rough right now, but it's getting better all the time. And you saw that big iron tower. That was a water tower that we put up there for our showers. And we're going to have hotter showers than we had at camp time, but it did work. And the shower houses are built, and we're getting that little accomplished. We didn't have dorms this year. And our cook shack was the cook tent this year, and they did most of the cooking outside. Actually, it was better to do it outside than in the tent because it was pretty warm in the tent. But that's all coming, and it's getting better. The views up there are great. It's really, really pretty, the lake and the valley, the Jess Valley. It's just green, and there's wildflowers all over the place, and big pine trees and junipers, and there's bulls snorting and hooting. I don't know. They make all kinds of. It sounds like a donkey out there sometimes, and it sounds like the first night Tawny said she was sleeping in her camper, and she thought some bird was out there making noises, and she woke up in the morning. It was that bull out there in the field and throwing dust and stuff. But anyway, it's really a beautiful place, and looking forward to having a lot more time there. Anybody have any questions about any of the pictures? The best campers were Nathan and Eleanor, and so the runner-ups were James. That's Nathan's cousin from Washington. He was the one up in the tree and had a bunch of stuff in his hair at times, but him and Ann were runner-up, so they did really good. We had a good time, and the cooking was phenomenal. It was really good cooking, and you could just go up there for that alone. It'd be worth it. Really, really appreciate the time up there. All right, if you'd like to turn with me to Mark, the first chapter, Mark chapter 1, yes. No, everybody needs to bring food for yourself, just like you were camping out on your own. Bring your own cooking utensils, your own coolers, and things like that. And we're not going to have a central cooking place. I suppose we could plug in a few fridges if you needed to use those up there, fridges and freezers. There's some up there. We could plug them in if people need that for the time of camp. So, but other than that, there are picnic tables in that central area if you want to eat in that area, but you'd have to cook at your own camp. All right, in Mark, the first chapter, we have a story here that's related also in Matthew, the 8th chapter, and in Luke, the 12th chapter. This is in three of the Gospels anyway. And this is at the beginning of Jesus' career when he revealed himself as the Messiah. In Mark chapter 1, verse 40. And I've titled this, The Disgusting Action of Jesus. And you might think, what could Jesus do that's so disgusting? And here it is in this verse here in Mark chapter 1, verse 40. And he says, there came a leper to him, beseeching him and kneeling down to him and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him and said to him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy departed from him and he was cleansed. And he straightly charged him and forthwith sent him away and said unto him, see that thou say nothing to any man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. But he went out and began to publish it much, and to blaze abroad the matter, insomuch that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in the desert places, and they came to him from every quarter. This is really quite an amazing story, and at first glance, we don't really realize the importance of this story in the way that it looks in the gospel, because we're looking at it from our perspective of the 21st century. But in his day, this was really an amazing thing. This is really an amazing thing. Now, if I ask you tonight, what is the largest organ in the human body? What do you think it is? What's the largest organ in the human body? Everybody knows the answer because we've heard it before, right? The skin. The skin is the largest organ that we have. I think it weighs about 15 pounds if you were able to take it off and just put it by itself. The average adult has 21 square feet of skin, and the average overweight adult has a little bit more than that. So you can imagine about that. It weighs 9 pounds, not 15 pounds. And it contains more than 11 million miles of, or more than 11 miles of blood vessels. Your skin holds your body together. It protects the various organs, and it protects you from various dangerous bacteria and viruses. In hot weather, your skin can release as much as 3 gallons of water in a day, which is amazing. And I used to work in a factory where the temperature inside the factory was often around 120, 130 degrees, and they would give us salt tablets, and they would give us water and ice, and we'd be drinking all day. I drank 5 gallons a day, and you know, you never had to go to the bathroom. You never had to, because you're just sweating it right out, you know, and your skin can do that. However, it's interesting that there's certain places on your skin that don't sweat. Do you sweat inside your eardrums? No. Isn't that kind of nice? Wouldn't it be bad if your eardrums sweat and your ears filled up with water? You don't sweat around your lips. You notice that? The sweat doesn't run into your mouth. It runs off your forehead. It could run down in there. It doesn't sweat underneath your nail beds. And a single square inch of skin has about 300 sweat glands. Most people think that the only reason that we have fingerprints is so that the police can identify us if there's a murder. But if you think about fingerprints, everyone is unique. And it's an original masterpiece. And Mark Lowry says, look at your thumb. He says, you're thumb buddy because you have that fingerprint on your finger. And those actually help us grip things. If we didn't have fingerprints, we wouldn't be able to grip stuff as easily as we do. It's a pretty amazing thing that we have the skin that we have. Unborn children don't develop fingerprints until they are about 3 months in the womb, and there are several genetic defects where people never develop fingerprints at all. Really, really rare, but that they don't have them. And then, this is pretty amazing, did you know that you are like a snake? Your skin, every 28 days or so, renews itself. About 50,000 skin cells you shed every minute. You guys are making a mess in here right now, all right? And 50,000 skin cells a minute, and in 28 days, the skin cells grow from the bottom of the epidermis to the outer layer, and they fall off. And so every 28 days, just like a snake that sheds its skin, we shed our skin in a similar fashion. And up to about 9 pounds of dead skin cells a year. So even if you don't diet or exercise, you can lose 9 pounds a year, but it does grow back. So you don't actually, there's not a net loss. Anyway, globally, dead skin accounts for about 1 billion tons of dust in the atmosphere. And that's kind of scary if you think about it, all the stuff that we're breathing in. You think it's bad when there's a forest fire around here and there's smoke. Man, imagine what's going on if you're in a big crowd of people. You know, you've been to a concert, or you go to a baseball game, or you go to a crowded adventure park or something like that. You're breathing in a lot of skin cells from everybody around you. That could probably creep you out if you thought about it too much, so you better not do that. But this is a creation of God, and it's implausible to me that people deny the design of God in creation, because you cannot help but see it. And you can watch National Geographic shows, and they have this, it's amazing the way that these animals have evolved over millions of years, and they can perfectly form to fit this flower, or they can perfectly do this. That thing on the bulletin this morning, that assassin bug, it rubs a camphor on its belly, and it coats its eggs in camphor so ants don't eat it. It's an ant repellent, a natural repellent. Man, it figured that out all by itself. That's amazing. No, God designed it that way. All right? You know, and what is wrong with people? That's why it says, a fool says in his heart, there is no God. And each square, square inch of skin contains 300 sweat glands, but it also contains 1,000 nerve endings. 1,000 nerve endings. And you have 5 different types of receptors in your skin that help you respond to pain and touch. And blind people, when they become blind, their brain actually rewires. And it also said this in the bulletin a few weeks ago, that if like a left-handed person, they use their part of the brain. That part of the brain works more. The more you use it, the more it develops, and it makes it better to use. And so, and if you don't use it, then it goes away. So that's why it's good to exercise your brain and exercise your mind. And we do that through the study of God's Word as a great exercise of the brain and mind. And you can do that. But it's just amazing the way God has created us. Those that are blind, or they become blind, they literally can see the world through touch and sound, and they're able to feel what's around them. And so the ability to feel is very critical to our survival. In the 1940s, they did an experiment, and there was 26 children in this orphanage. They were born in this orphanage, and they decided to see what would happen if they had minimal contact with people. How would they develop if they had minimal contact with people? And so in some cases, these kids were just left in their cribs. Their diapers were changed. They were fed. But the minimal amount of human contact. In fact, in one case, there was one nurse was assigned to seven different children. And by the time these babies were a year old, these isolated babies were less curious, they were less playful, and they were more subject to infections. And by the time they were in their second and third year of life, only two of the 26 could even talk or could walk and manage a few words. Now, that's Charlie's age. That's Julie's age right there, two or three years old. And can you imagine not being able to talk or walk? Charlie, you can have a conversation with him. He has complete sentences, and he'll tell you all about it, all right? And anyway, the ability to be touched to be touched can make a difference in our lives. And so in our text today, Jesus did something that was disgusting in the eyes of those that were following him. And you can imagine what his apostles would think when he walked up, and this guy, he goes, "Don't you realize that this is a leper? Don't you realize this is a person that is untouchable? We're not even supposed to be near this guy. We're not even supposed to be around this person." And in certain conditions, the Talmud said that that had leprosy. The Talmud is a collection of rabbinical writings, and there was a lot of traditions that the Jews went by. But they said that you couldn't get within 6 feet of a leper. And if it was windy, you couldn't get within 150 feet of a leper, because they knew that disease could be blown over to them or something. And so when Jesus met this guy and he went up and he did that, that was disgusting to these people. How could he do this? He touched him before he healed him, didn't he? He touched him. And this was reckless. This was completely reckless. Reach out and do this to a clearly infected leper. Leprosy is a terrible disease. In Leviticus, the 13th chapter, Leviticus chapter 13, this whole chapter is basically dedicated to diagnosing and treating leprosy. And the priest had a big responsibility in this chapter. They had to look at the wound, and they had to determine what kind of wound it was, and then they had to go back after a certain number of days, and if it had healed up, or if it hadn't healed up, or if the hair had turned white, or if the scab had turned yellow, or whatever it was, they had all these things where they could diagnose leprosy. But look here in Leviticus, the 13th chapter, and verse 44. Leviticus chapter 13, verse 44. "If he is a leprous man, he is unclean, and the priest shall pronounce him utterly unclean. And his plague is in his head." This was a certain case there with the hair. And they had different cases all the way through this chapter. Verse 45, it says, "And the leper in whom the plague is, his clothes shall be rent," that means torn, "and his head bare, and he shall put a covering upon his upper lip and shall cry, 'Unclean, unclean.'" You know what that is? That's masks. He had to put a thing over his mouth, over his upper lip. He had to put a mask on. And this is from the Bible. This is the first institute of mask mandates. You want to find out where it is? This is where it started. And they had to put this on, and he had to yell, "Unclean! Unclean!" It's a terrible disease. If it's untreated, people will live an average of about 10 years. And it usually starts with a feeling of fatigue and pain in the joints. Scaly spots develop on the skin. Body becomes covered with lumps and filled with pus. The face changes its shape. Some sufferers become to resemble a lion. Growths develop on the vocal cords, and their voice becomes raspy. The body begins to decompose, and they start to stink terribly. Leprosy is still a major disease today. According to Hughes Medical Center, there are 200 new cases of leprosy each year in the United States and 700,000 worldwide. India, Indonesia, Myanmar, Brazil have the greatest numbers of outbreaks of leprosy. So statistically, there are 65 new cases every hour, even today. Can you believe that? And leprosy is also called Hansen's disease, and it's chronic infectious disease, and it is carried by airborne bacteria. Isn't it amazing how the Bible was right about that even before we knew about bacteria? Like I said, the Talmud said they had to stay 6 feet away from people, 150 feet if there was wind. According to the Mishnah, another tradition of the Jews, anyone who touched a leper, was near a leper, or touched anything a leper had touched or entered his or her home, he was ceremonially unclean. And you look at what happened with the clothes, you know, there in the Old Testament, they had to burn the clothes because they recognized that the clothes were contaminated. They recognized that whatever they touched was contaminated. And so this is how they would treat it. And so they were isolated. But even the isolation wasn't the worst part, because leprosy often deprives the person infected of the feeling of touch. And so a leper could step on a thorn, or he could hurt his foot on a rock or something and not feel it, not even know that there was a problem with his foot until it's too late and it began to rot. Or they could drop a potato in the fire and reach in the fire, grab that potato, not realize that they were burnt on their hand because they couldn't feel it. And so an infection would happen, and the injured foot might fall off. They could wash themselves with scalding water and not know it's scalding and blind themselves. It's just really a terrible thing. They were forbidden to be touched. They were forbidden to be around them. And they had so many restrictions against them. And if you touch a leper, you risk that infection. And so you can imagine, it's just like when you're a little kid in the playground and girls have cooties, man. You do not touch a girl if you know what's good for you, right? When you're little, and then when you're about 12 or 13, you figure out that the girls don't all have cooties, and you find a special one that you kind of like. But anyway, this was like that back in those days. No, it was a social disgrace, and you didn't want to be around them or anything like that. Just a terrible thing. But then Jesus comes along, and here's this leper, and people know that he's a leper. You can't hide the fact that you're a leper. You know, you could hide a lot of things, but you can't hide the fact that you're a leper. And he comes along, and he just reaches out, and knowing that this who this guy was, he touches him. I don't know how long it had been before this moment since that guy had been touched. He couldn't shake people's hands. He couldn't kiss somebody on the cheek. I don't know if he had a wife. I don't know if he had kids. He couldn't hold his kids. He couldn't hug his wife. You know, all these things. And it might have been years since that guy had ever been touched. And Jesus comes along. He goes, I will. And he touched him. He had full of compassion on this man and touched him. And the man was an outcast, shunned by society, cut off from God. And this is the very person, the type of person that Jesus came to heal. And like I said, the Jews might not have known if you were a tax collector just by the way you looked. They might not have known if you were a prostitute by the way you looked. They might not have known you had some other kind of sins, but if you were a leper, they knew who you were. All right? They knew who they were. They were marked by the priest. They had to be shown to the priest, and they did this. But Jesus comes and do this. And the power of Jesus to heal lepers is one of his ways that he identifies himself. If you look at Matthew chapter 11, and this is where one of John's disciples came to Jesus, and John is beginning to doubt. He's in prison, and he's getting discouraged, and he wants to make sure that Jesus is who he says he is. In Matthew, the 11th chapter, it says, now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples, and he said to them, art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Are you really him? Are you really the Messiah? And Jesus answered and said to them, go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. And so here, one of the things that Jesus uses to verify who he is I have the ability to cleanse the lepers. All right, and this isn't something that you can fake. There's a lot of charlatans today, and there's a lot of people that will try to say that there's spiritual healers. All right, if there really was spiritual healers, why do we still have hospitals? Why do people get sick? You know, and if there really was these guys that could do this, and we know that Jesus didn't heal everybody that was there in the time of when he walked on earth, but these guys, you know, they're a bunch of charlatans, and it's just like the magician. Once you see how he does the trick, it's no longer a mystery. He's, oh, that's how he did it. Man, some of those magicians are really good. They're really fast, and the sleight of hand, they can really make you think one thing when they're doing another thing. And it's the same thing with these spiritual healers. We've all heard the stories. I heard about one spiritual healer, and anytime somebody was kind of old or elderly, and they walk kind of, hey, would you like a wheelchair? We can put you right down front if you sit in this wheelchair. And then during the service, he'd come, stand up and walk. Well, the guy could walk when he came in, but he just got set down at the front of the, you know, and there's people that have earpieces in, and they have questionnaires already filled out about all these people, and they can tell what kind of illnesses they have, and it's all planned out ahead of time, all right? And it's interesting. My wife had a student in her class this last year that had no background in the Bible. She had no background, and the first introduction to the Bible was being here at school. And so as part of her class, my wife will play audio Bible stories for them to listen to about different things. And this little girl is so skeptical because she's seen all the movies and things like, that's just CGI, isn't it? You know, and Jesus, or the waters parting for Moses to cross, and you know, all these miracles that God does, or, you know, and walking on the water, or the miracle of healing people, or raising over the dead. Well, that's just like a movie. We know that can happen in a movie. That doesn't really happen in real life. And sometimes we become like that. But this was not a fake, and you could document this was a person that was really sick. This was a person that couldn't walk. This was a person that couldn't hear. This was a person that was born blind. And these were the people that were being healed. And so this was Jesus' validation that he was who he said he was. And these works bore witness of him. In John, the fifth chapter, he basically says the same thing. In John chapter 5, verse 36, because I have a greater witness than that of John, for the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me, that the Father hath sent me. Now, there had been a lot of false teachers that come, and even some of the critics of Jesus said, well, who knows what some babbler will say? You know, there every once in a while we get some false teacher that drags a lot of people out in the desert, and they do a lot of different things, and this is just another guy like that, probably. And they put Jesus in that same class, but Jesus was in a separate class because he could actually do these works. The dead were raised. The lame did walk. The lepers were cleansed. And this verified that the Father had sent him. And so the people that Jesus healed were his calling card, and one of the most prominent healings was the healing of a leper. But the real story was not that Jesus healed the leper. The real story was that Jesus touched the leper. Now, as a parent, you guys have had to do very disgusting things. I know. If you have a little boy and you've changed a diaper, how many have got peed on when they're trying to change a diaper? That's ever happened to you? All right. How many have gotten pooped on? All right. How many have gotten thrown up on? All right. We would do that for our kids when we wouldn't do that for another person in the world, right? Because that's disgusting. We don't like that. All right. And here, this leper, even his own family wouldn't dare to touch him. The people that were closest to him in his life, that loved him the most, they couldn't afford to do that. They couldn't touch him. But Jesus could. Jesus could touch him. And it's not really unusual that Jesus touched someone when he healed them. We know that Peter's mother-in-law was healed, and Jesus held her by the hand. And then he touched the eyes of the blind man. Remember, he makes the spit in mud, and man, it, if you were just observing that from a distance and didn't know what was going on, what is this crazy guy doing? You know, and did he practice this as a kid? That's what I want to know. The other kids, quit spitting in my eye, you know, and I don't know if that all went on, but he put his ears or his hands in the ears of the deaf man, and then he touched the girl on her deathbed. He touched her, said, "Arise and walk." And Jesus touched many people that he healed, but he didn't have to touch them. Look at Luke, the 17th chapter, and you'll remember this story. In Luke, the 17th chapter, he was passing through Samaria. And that, another thing, that's a big deal there too. In Luke 17, verse 11, "And it came to pass, he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee." You know what the Jews did when they went from Nazareth to Jerusalem? They went out to the east, over the Jordan River, south, around Samaria, back across the Jordan River, and they went to Jerusalem. You know, they didn't want to go through Samaria because Samaria was full of Samaritans. And they didn't want to talk to the Samaritans. They didn't want to deal with the Samaritans. They didn't want to, they were like dogs in their opinion. They were half-bred, and a mixed breed, and you know, they just didn't like them. But Jesus went right through that area. It didn't seem to bother him. And verse 12, it says, "He entered into a certain village, and there he met 10 men that were lepers, and they stood afar off." So they're obeying the Talmud, all right? Now, according to some sources I've recently studied, is the Samaritans accepted the law of Moses, the five books of Moses, but they didn't accept the rest of the Old Testament books. And so they didn't accept all the Talmud and teachings like that, but they did accept the five books of Moses. But they were following this, and this was the law of Moses. They stood afar off. They lifted up their voices and they said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And when he saw them, he said, "Go show yourselves to the priest." And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. Now, if they didn't really believe that this could happen, they wouldn't have gone, right? So their faith, as they went, made the way for them to be cleansed. So as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. And he fell down on his face at his feet and he gave thanks. And he was, what? A Samaritan. He was a Samaritan, that's right. And Jesus answered and said, "Wasn't there 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? They are not found that return to give glory to God except this stranger." And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Your faith hath made you whole." Now, did Jesus touch these 10 lepers? He didn't touch them. All right? The power of God is not limited to what we want to limit it to. And he didn't have to touch the leper in Mark, the first chapter, but he did. All right? And this shows here clearly that he healed these guys without touching them. And he didn't have to do that, but he did. Why would he touch this man that was deformed by horrible and unclean disease, when he really didn't have to? If you look back in Matthew or Mark, the first chapter in verse 41, it says he was moved with compassion. The English Standard Version says he was moved with pity. And he could see the hurt in this man's life, couldn't he? He could see that this man was a man that needed the touch of the Savior. A preacher went to visit a woman in the hospital, and as he approached her ward, the sign said, "Please see the nurse before entering." And so he went to the nurse's station and explained that he didn't know what the woman was suffering from, but she was very contagious. And so in order to go see her, he had to put a mask and a robe and a gown, and he had to put latex gloves on, and they really had to wash up and everything, and then he could go and talk to her. And he got to the woman's bedside, and she smiled weakly, and she told him how good it was to see him. And they talked for a long time, and it came time for him to leave. The preacher asked if there's anything he could do for her. She goes, "I just wish somebody would hold my hand without one of those gloves on." See, we crave human touch. We really crave human touch. And that was one of the saddest things about this whole COVID thing, is the isolation that some of these people died where they couldn't see their loved ones, all except for on a video or through a window, and we couldn't touch them. It's just a really sad situation that they had to go through. But you know, care and emotion and love are communicated through touch, aren't they? Through physical touch. And in John, the first chapter, it says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus became flesh and dwelt among us. And John 3:16, we know it says, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He gave us Jesus Christ in the form of a man, in the form of a Savior, that we could touch with our hands, that we could see with our eyes, that we could listen to, and we could tell what was going on. Touching people was one of the most basic ways that Jesus, God in the flesh, could show people that He loved them and He cared for them. And He had pity on them for what they suffered in this world. You know, when a baby is first born, what's one of the first things they do? They put it on the mother's chest. And the best thing is skin-to-skin contact, right? Basic, bare skin to bare skin. I think that's right. And it's supposed to be therapeutic for the baby and the mother. It's one of the best things that can happen. And that touch, that human touch, it's a way that we can feel that love that happens. And it creates a connection between the ones who are touched and the one that touches. It's interesting how John describes Jesus in 1 John, the first chapter. In 1 John, the first chapter, in verse 1, it says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show it to you, that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with His Son, Jesus Christ. You know what he's saying? And remember, John is the same one that wrote the book of John, and how did he start that book off? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then it says in verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as of the only firstborn of the Father. And here he says, that which we have seen, the Word of life, that which we have handled, that's our hands have touched. You know, and so he says, this is the real thing. This is Jesus Christ in the flesh. I have seen it. I've touched Him. I've felt Him. You know, and Thomas, he wasn't convinced until he could put his finger in the holes of his hands and his fist in his side. That touch was what convinced Thomas. And what did Thomas say? My Lord and my God, right? He recognized when he touched Christ what a difference that would make. And so we see the love of God communicated by human touch. It is said that in the East, and shepherds, when they go back to the fold each night, the shepherd will stand at the entrance to the pen, and as he counts the sheep as they're coming in the pen, he'll lay his hand on the head of each sheep as it goes in. And it makes a habit of touching each of them. In fact, he does touch his sheep so many times throughout the day. And this shows his love and care and affection for him. And you've seen it in your pets. When an animal gets used to physical touch, and it craves it, doesn't it? And I go over to my son's house, his dog goes nuts. He wants me to scratch him and pet him and behind the ears, everything like that. Just can't get enough of it. I seen a video, this girl came home from college with a bull, a Hereford bull, all right? And you know this bull loves to play, loves to be scratched in the head. When I was a kid, we lived out on the edge of Eugene, we had a goat. This goat loved to play with us, you know, and loved to have be scratched on the head, and we had pushing wars. You grab onto its horns and push it, and some days my mom would let it loose, and it would meet us at the bus stop. It's a crazy thing, this goat come running out the bus stop. And anyway, I even seen a video one time where this guy had a fish, and the fish just loved to be touched. It would swim into the guy's hands, and he'd hold it, and the fish would swim away and swim back. Just, they learned, they crave it. And it's a way that love is shown, that once they are used to the human touch, they crave it. It's just how we are. That interaction is shown that way. And Jesus is called the Good Shepherd in John, the 10th chapter. We'll go ahead and read this real fast here. John, the 10th chapter, starting in verse 1. Verily I say unto you, he that enters not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbs in some other way, the same as a thief and a robber, but he that enters in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. And to him the porter opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls and enters his sheep by, he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. And he puts forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger they will not follow, but he will flee from him, but they will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. All right, and it's the same thing with cows and things. My grandpa, I guess, used to call in the cows, and he did it a certain way, but if you didn't do it the same way, the cows wouldn't come. Would they, I don't know, would they come for you when you called them in? They'd only call, come for your for my grandpa. All right, I don't know. And, you know, they did that, and they know the voice. They know, and so, and he goes on this whole passage here, showing the care of the shepherd, and the shepherd is there to save the life of his sheep. He'll give his own life for the life of his sheep. That's how much he cares for the sheep. But the thief doesn't come for that reason. The thief comes to steal and to kill and destroy, but he has come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. And so we really have a good shepherd that cares for us, and he wants to touch our lives as well. He shows his love and care for us in the most basic way. He touches us. And but there's a little problem here. Sometimes a Christian will get to the point in life where they've been touched by Christ, and they get the impression that it's all about me, and it's all about Jesus is touching me and meeting my needs and answering my prayers. Focus on myself. But that's not the reason that Jesus touched us, is it? In 1 John 4, and this is a song we sang at camp one night. 1 John 4, verse 7, it says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that is born of God and knoweth God, everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God, and he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." And so we're supposed to show the love of God like we've been shown God's love. We have been shown God's love for the purpose that we can show it to others. I mean, let's turn there. There's more verses in that passage I want to read. In 1 John 4, and you skip down to verse 16. Verse 16, it says, "And we have known and believed that the love of God has to us, God is love, and he that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. And herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world." All right? As Christ loved us, we are to be that kind of a loving person as well. Verse 18, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loves God loves his brother also." And so when God touches us, when God reached down in our despicable state, and we were in that state, we were in a state of sin, and we were as disgusting as that leper was in the way that we were, God said, I will make you clean. And we submitted to repentance, and we submitted to the watery grave of baptism, and he brought us up to walk in newness of life. He made us clean. He brought us, made us a new flesh, and wiped all those disgusting sins away, wiped all our past away, and remembers it no more. All right? And so we're supposed to have that kind of an attitude and that kind of love for other people. And we're not just saved to be saved. We're saved to tell others how to be saved. And Jesus calls us to be people who are determined to touch people who need to be touched. Now, in Romans, the 16th chapter, verse 16, there's an interesting verse there. And this might be a good pickup line for you, Nathan. All right, you say to a girl, "Do you believe in Romans 16, 16? You know what it says here? You don't know what it says? Salute one another with a holy kiss, all right? And if you're dating, this is a great verse, right? As long as it's just your girlfriend or boyfriend, right? No, this is, but, you know, the church, we need to touch each other. And that's why I think it was so bad during the 2020 when we had to isolate and we couldn't get together and we couldn't shake hands and we couldn't eat together and we couldn't fellowship. You know, the we're made to be physical people, and we're made to be this way. I saw somebody pat Wayne Cobb on the head this morning just because that's the kind of, do you know who that was, Mr. Cobb? You don't remember it happening? You don't recall it? Yeah. All right. And, you know, when Robert Quinn first moved out here, he was staying with Eric Atkins, and Eric went up to Jim Rosasco, and he said, Jim, Robert's really lonely because he's been out here and he's away from his family, and he just needs a hug every, you know, he just needs as many hugs as he can get. And so Jim would come up and give Robert hugs every time he came to church, all right? So if you want to give Eric some hugs, all right, back, you know, to try to get him even with him. But anyway, Robert couldn't figure out why Jim was so friendly towards him, all right? But that's kind of interesting. anyway, but when you see your family, what do? You give them a big hug. You see your daughter or your son or your grandkids or somebody you haven't seen in a long time, your brother, your sister, whoever it is, you haven't seen them a while, you get together. When we get to Iowa, we hug everybody that comes in the door. You know, that when the cousins come over and the nieces and nephews, everybody gets a hug. You know, and that's just the tradition that we have in our family. And it's fine, and that's a good thing, as long as it's in love and it's pure and it's with these good motives. And we need this. We need the touch in the church. Jesus touched this man that nobody else would, and it was in this touch Jesus showed how much God loved him. And this touch has changed the lives of millions over the years. There's a man named Doug Nichols, and he went to India in 1967. He was part of a missionary outreach, and while he was there, he got tuberculosis, and he was forced to stay in a sanitarium for several months, and he didn't speak the language there, and he tried to hand out Christian tracts. He tried to give literature to the doctors and the nurses and the other patients that were in the ward with him, and everybody refused, and it was because they weren't very happy that a rich American, because in their mind, all Americans are rich, was staying in this government-run sanitarium, and he was taking advantage of their system. But they didn't know that this guy was actually broke. He didn't have two pennies to rub together. And so the first few nights, he woke around 2 a.m. coughing. And this is what he wrote. One morning during my coughing spell, I noticed one of the older and sicker patients across the aisle trying to get out of bed. And he would sit up on the edge of the bed and try to stand, but in weakness would fall back into the bed. And I didn't understand what he was trying to do. And he finally fell into the bed exhausted, and I heard him crying softly. The next morning, I realized what the man was trying to do. He was trying to get to the bathroom. The stench was awful. Other patients yelled insults at the man. Angry nurses moved him roughly from side to side as they cleaned up the mess. And one nurse even slapped him. The old man curled into a ball and wept. The next night, I woke up again coughing, and I noticed the man across the aisle sit up and again try to stand. Like the night before, he fell back whimpering. I don't like bad smells, and I don't want to become involved. But I got out of bed, and I went over to him. When I touched his shoulder, his eyes opened wide with fear. I smiled. I put my arms underneath him, and I picked him up. He was very light due to his old age and advanced TB. I carried him to the washroom, and if you've ever seen washrooms over in these kind of countries, it was a filthy small room with a hole in the floor. And I stood behind him with my arms under his armpits as he took care of himself. After he finished, I picked him up, and I carried him back to that bed. As I laid him down, he kissed me on the cheek, and he smiled, and he said something I couldn't understand. The next morning, a patient woke me and handed me a steaming cup of tea, and he motioned with his hands that he wanted a tract. As the sun rose, other patients approached, and they indicated that they too were interested in my little booklets. And throughout the day, nurses, interns, doctors, all asked for literature. Why were they interested now? The difference was because he had touched a man that others had avoided, and it changed the life of that whole ward. I want to give you an assignment. Try touching someone this week. Maybe there's somebody that you have a problem with, or somebody that you have a difference with. Maybe it's somebody in your family. Maybe it's somebody you work with. Maybe it's somebody that you don't like too well. Maybe they have a conflict in their lives. Maybe they're hard to get along with. Ask them if you can pray for them, and then reach out and grab their hand, or put your hand on their shoulder and pray right there for them. See if it makes a difference. Even if it doesn't make a difference to them, it will to you. Maybe visit a nursing home. Take some cookies to share. When I worked in Iowa, the guy that hired me at the grocery store, he was a manager of the grocery store, his name was James Simmons. And his father lived in northern Iowa, and his father did something I haven't heard of anybody else doing. He would go and minister to the people at the nursing homes. And he would actually go in and he would clip their toenails. The nurses really appreciated him. He'd go in on all the old guys and he got those big toenail clippers and stuff, and he'd just go in and show that he cared about them and clip their toenails. Some of us said, man, I'm out. I couldn't do that. God, I'll do anything else, but not that, right? You know, and wouldn't be able to do that. But imagine what a difference that man made. You can make a difference in somebody else's lives by reaching out and touching him and showing him that you care, that you love him. We're going to sing the song, He Touched Me. I think they got the words on the screen. And you guys know this song. This has been around for a while. And so let's all stand as we sing this song tonight. And the church at Reno, that's not it. Let's see if they got it. Shackled by a heavy burden. There it is. Neath a load of guilt and shame. All right. If you need God to touch your life, maybe you haven't been cleansed. Maybe you haven't been made whole. Maybe you're as disgusting as that leper was. If you have a need to be cleansed and be whole and let Jesus touch you, come tonight and let that happen. Know the healing of Jesus' touch in your life. Attention tonight, and we appreciate being here, part of the church. If you need the Lord's Supper served to you, didn't have a chance to partake it, make sure you get a hold of Wayne Cobb, and he'll serve it to you. Are you doing that in room one, Wayne, or in the kitchen? Oh, across from the kitchen. Okay, so that's where you need to head if you need the Lord's Supper tonight. Remember all the announcements coming up, and be part of those. Next thing we have is next Sunday, fifth Sunday, potluck and Sinkspiration. Looking forward to a good time there. All right, let's be dismissed tonight. Brother Ken Mickey, can you pray for us as we dismiss? You are dismissed.